So this topic today will be dedicated on macrocalcifications in breast mammography. The learning objective is first to become familiar with different types of breast calcification. Second, to learn the different tools to biopsy calcification clusters. And third, to learn the differential diagnosis of calcifications. First, this is a very important topic because we have to know that macrocalcification clusters are very common on mammography. This is a basic findings on mammography. They could be benign as secretion calcifications, and also they could be malignant, and in this way they could correspond to necrosis. They are mainly detected on mammography. A careful analysis is required because macrocalcification cluster may be the only findings of a carcinoma, especially a DCIS, ductal carcinoma in situ, on mammography. It corresponds roughly to 16% of all cancer detected on mammography. So the definition of a macrocalcification cluster is quite simple. It's a group of 3 to 5 macrocalcification clusters in 2 square centimeters. Size of this calcification is lower than 1 millimeter, and a cluster macrocalcification could be benign or malignant. So first, how to explore calcification clusters? The basic views of mammography are usually a craniocaudal and mediolateral oblique, so CC and MLO view. But in case you detect some macrocalcification clusters on mammography, you need additional views, such as a mediolateral view. And also, you will need magnification views, usually on CC and on mediolateral. That's very important to have the mediolateral views in magnification and to have 2 orthogonal views. Also, ultrasound is required to explore calc cluster. We don't see not all the calcifications in ultrasound, but sometimes we could see the calcification on ultrasound, and it could be easier to biopsy them on ultrasound. Here is an example of a macrocalcification cluster on this mediolateral and craniocaudal view. On this view, it's a mediolateral view, you see that there is some irregular calcifications defined in a triangle orientation. This is typically a DCIS macrocalcification cluster. You have the same image here on the CC view, again with irregular dense calcifications, obvious, suspicious. And when we performed the ultrasound, we detected this calcification within a dense mass inside the ultrasound tissue here, and it was seen here on the ultrasound. It was a pure DCIS, not an invasive one, but sometimes you can have the chance to see the calcifications on ultrasound. The question, is tomosynthesis accurate to detect calcs? We know today that tomosynthesis could be more accurate for non-calcified lesions such as asymmetry, masses, and distortion. Usually, calcs look brighter on tomosynthesis, they could be more detectable, but we have to be careful because morphology could be modified for calcification with DBT. So some amorphous calcs could look bigger and brighter, and thus more likely benign, so it could change your interpretations. And also we have to be aware that some low density calcs may not be visible on tomosynthesis, especially on synthetic view. So we have to be careful when analyzing macrocalcification clusters on DBT. And that's why magnification views are still needed if you perform a DBT analysis of your breast. There are anyway some publications about tomosynthesis and macrocalcification clusters. In these publications, they evaluate many patients with macrocalcification clusters, benign and malignant. So the criteria of this visibility and detection were visibility, contrast, and distribution of the calcification. And so finally, they also find they had better analysis and better descriptions of the calcifications in DBT in comparison with full field digital. So maybe because also of the enhanced contrast of the calcifications. Here is an example of a macrocalcification cluster with DBT and full field 2D mammography. This is a benign cluster with a cystic one with a linear shape here, and these calcifications look more brighter on tomosynthesis in comparison with 2D mammography. The shape is a little less defined on DBT in comparison, but due to a higher contrast, calcification clusters are more visible. Then, how to analyze a calcification cluster? First step, we have to confirm that these are real calcification clusters and not artifacts, very important. Second, to assess this is a typically benign calcification or not. Then, to look for associated findings such as mass, distortions, retraction, etc. Four, to analyze morphological findings and density. Five, to analyze distribution within the breast. Six, to analyze if it's homogeneous or not. Seven, to analyze the amount of calcification in one cluster. And last step, very important, to analyze if it's evolutive or not. That's why that's very important to compare your mammography with the previous mammography and to ask the patients to bring their previous mammography. At the end of these different steps, to analyze the cluster, you have to synthesize and to provide a classification category according BI-RADS and define a strategy, a biopsy or follow-up or nothing. Step one, first step, it's the basic step to confirm if it's a real calcification or not. And so the aim is to eliminate artifacts and calcs outside the breast. To avoid artifacts, you have to avoid cream, antiperspirants, tattoos, hair on the films. If you have suspicions of artifacts, then you have to clean the skin and retake the view. These artifacts usually are seen in only one view. Also, you have very common extramammary calcs, which are could be subcutaneous calcs, like in this view. These round calcifications are seen in the skin here. Also, you could have some calcified filariasis, which is a parasitis, so located also in the skin of the breast. Also, you could have foreign body calc. Then, in the new classifications of BI-RADS, it's quite simple. First, we have typically benign calcifications and suspicious calcifications, so nearly two categories. The only categories for probably benign calcifications is in two categories, in small round punctated 1 mm calcs and diffuse amorphous calcs. So let's see some examples of typically benign calcifications. These are vascular calcifications. Here, as you can see in this mammography, with typically benign vascular calcifications. This patient has diabetes and it could be a marker of arteriosclerosis. Another case of typically benign calcifications, calcification size when the size is larger than 1 mm are usually benign, as in these examples of a coarse popcorn-like calcified fibroadenoma, typically benign as in this case. Other typically benign calcifications, such as in this treated breast, with scar calcifications and steatonecrosis. How do you define steatonecrosis? These are usually peripheral linear calcifications with an hypodense fat center. Also, we have the same calcifications here with vascular and post-treatment calcifications in this treated breast. I would make a special focus of an entity which is called large board-like calcs. They are quite common, usually associated with ductyloxtasia with a larger diameter, larger than 0.5 millimeters. And the key is a ductal distribution with periductal or intraductal as a needle shape. And when you have this needle shape, usually it's benign. It's usually bilateral and regular with, in women, usually older than 60. Be careful, because the differential diagnosis of these calcifications is an extensive DCIS. And the key to differentiate these calcifications are irregular branching calcs. So same orientations, but with irregular calcs, with diameter usually lower than 0.5 millimeters. Here is an example of these large, broad-like benign calcs, as you can see here in this example, with they are towards the nipple here, with a ductal orientation, but a needle shape, very irregular, very large calcifications. In this case, it's typically benign. Also, in this case, a treated breast with large, broad-like calcs, very dense, in this case, very large, with an orientation through the nipple. Be careful, because in this case, it's completely different. There is still a nipple orientation, but the calcs are segmental, irregular, with lower than 0.5 millimeters. They are not benign, they are typically malignant, suggestive, and extensive DCIS. We could be classified by RADS 5. In this case, it's very different. There are only ductal ectasia here. They were regular with needle shape orientation. In this case, it's malignant. In this case, it could be classified as Barrett's 2. Other examples of typically benign calcifications, these are cystic calcifications with linear orientations, usually encountered in calcified cysts. Also, they could be round with a clear center with rim calcifications on the CC view. It's typically benign and it could be classified as Barrett's 2. Again, here, so these are rim calcifications with linear orientations on the CC view and the mediatorial view. Here, in this case, it's typically benign and encountered in cystic calcification clusters, and it's Barrett's 2. Step 3, you have to look for associated findings. If you find a suspicious mass associated to irregular calcifications clusters, then you have to categorize as Barrett's 5, and it's usually suggestive of an invasive carcinoma. Also, when you have suspicious calcification with distortion and density associated with calc, it could be categorized as Barrett's 5, typically malignant. Here are some examples of associated findings. So these calcifications are very suspicious due to the number of calcifications, the density, the pleomorphism. They are irregular with a triangle orientation, and they are associated with the density. Here it was an invasive DCIS. In this case, these calcifications also are associated with the dense tissue here and very suspicious on these magnification views. It was also a DCIS. Step 4, you have to analyze morphology and density of your calcifications, and I would describe 4 descriptors suggesting suspicious macrocalcifications. First, when it's amorphous, which means no real shape to describe, usually with very low density and low size of the calcifications. This is suspicious. Second, coarse, heterogeneous, irregular, usually bigger, and dense calcifications, but it's suspicious. Three, fine pleomorphic, so that means many size, many different size, with lower size, suspicious. And last descriptors, it means fine linear or fine linear branching with ductal orientations, usually with a low size, extremely suspicious and suggestive of DCIS. Let's see some examples. In this case, we have amorphous calcifications with very low density, low size calcifications. Anyway, it was suspicious, it was finally a DCIS. In this case, it's quite different, but with coarse, heterogeneous, dense calcifications with irregular shape, it's also a DCIS. Fine pleomorphic with several calcification clusters, as in this view, all these views are magnification views. Also with pleomorphic, different size, different orientation, very suspicious. And last image, it corresponds to fine linear branching, segmental orientation with a triangular shape, typically malignant, suggestive of DCIS. After morphology and density, you have to describe the distribution analysis. We define a grouped cluster with more than 5 calcifications in a low size, lower than 1 centimeter. Usually it's suspicious. A linear distribution is more suspicious. Segmental orientation suggestive DCIS. Diffuse orientation, that means distributed randomly throughout the breast, it could be benign. And a regional, so big cluster of calcifications in a larger area, larger than 2 centimeters, usually with no ductal orientations. It could be benign and it could be malignant. Here is an example of diffuse calcifications, such as in this case, you have irregular calcifications, but you have also vascular calcifications, as in this case, it's benign. In this view, you have a segmental orientation of regional calcifications. Most of these calcifications are low size calcifications with a triangular orientation towards the nipple. Of course, it's suspicious it was a DCIS. This is an example of a group cluster, so a low size cluster of calcifications. Here in this case, this magnification view lower than 1 centimeter, but it was done with irregular calcification, so it's a DCIS in this case. And this is an example of linear calcifications toward the nipples. Of course, it's typically malignant due to the orientations and the irregular calcifications and dense calcifications. And last, this segmental calcification, segmental distribution with very dense, irregular, suggestive DCIS, a typical one. So to summarize, these are the Barrett's categories for these descriptors of calcifications. As you can see, finally, nearly all the descriptors will define either benign or suspicious calcification, so either Barrett's 2 or either Barrett's 4. Only 2 entities could be defined as Barrett's 3, so probably benign, a grouped or regional round or punctated calcifications clusters, and amorphous calcification cluster with diffuse orientations. All these other calcifications could be benign or suspicious. It's recommended today to subcategorize the Barrett's 4 category in 3 different categories. For A, which means 2 to 10% of cancer risk. For B, 10 to 50. For C, 50 to 95. And that's quite interesting today to subcategorize this Barrett's 4 category, especially if you perform biopsy to evaluate your results when comparing the histology and radiology. So these are examples of Barrett's 4 calcifications with amorphous shape lower than 0.5 millimeters. In this case, it was a grouped calcification clusters. For B, it was malignant. Another case of regional calcification, so more than 2 centimeters. In this case, it's a fine linear branching and suspicious calcification. So that's why it was categorized as Barrett's 4C and not Barrett's 4B. Another case of other descriptors, still Barat's four calcifications with course-like calcifications cluster, in this case with group cluster for this small DCIS, regional, also suspicious, and fine linear branching. And in this case, it was also categorized as Barat's 4C. And then fine linear, pleomorphic, diffuse here in this case with several clusters. Anyway, it was suspicious, it was DCIS. And in this case, with a grouped and a regional cluster in, of these calcifications, again, a DCIS. So be careful, we have only two entities, as I said, which could be classified as Barat 3 today. Two findings, so small cluster, lower than 1 centimeter, or round punctated calcifications, and diffuse and amorphous calcifications. Usually they are benign and correspond to secretions or calcifications cluster in lobular acini. This is an example of diffuse amorphous calcification clusters towards the breast. All these calcifications look the same with a benign shape, round, homogeneous, no pleomorphism, and no vary in size. There are benign calcifications. And also these small clusters could be categorized as Barrett 3 because they are located in a small area. They are round, less than 10 calcifications with a small cluster punctated calcifications. So for the Barrett 3 categories, that's very important to categorize as Barrett 3 a calcification cluster only after a diagnostic mammogram, not only after a screening test. So you need a medial lateral view and you need magnification views. If you categorize a calcification cluster as Barrett 3, then you have to perform a follow-up, which is recommended is a 6-month follow-up with a CC medial lateral view and also with magnification views on CC and medial lateral view for one breast. Then another follow-up of 12 months with the same views and also with a follow-up of the contralateral breast only with the CC and MLO views. At 2 years, another follow-up is exactly the same views than performed at 1 year. Some radiologists could perform another 3 years follow-up, but normally it's recommended after 2 years, either if it's stable to recategorize in Barrett 2, and if it's evolutive or modified and suspicious criteria, so increase of size, modifications of shape with irregular calcifications or appearance of mass or density look associated to calcification, then you could classify it as Barrett's 4 and perform a biopsy. So for if you categorize some calcification clusters as Barrett's 4 and Barrett's 5, then you will need to perform a biopsy. Which is recommended today is a stereotactic vacuum assisted biopsy with large needle with lower gauge than lower than 11 gauge. Usually the samples are quite big, 1 to 2 centimeter samples with 6 to 12 samples for one cluster. And you can remove entirely a calcification cluster. If there is no or few residual calcs, then that's very important to insert a titanium clip in your cavity to follow your patients. If a stereotactic vacuum is assisted biopsy is not available in your center, and if the lesions and calcifications are visible on ultrasound, you can still perform a core or vacuum biopsy under ultrasound guidance. It's a little bit more challenging, but it's still feasible. But very important to know that nowadays, a surgical biopsy should be avoided unless this percutaneous biopsy is not feasible. So how does it work? Stereotactic biopsy will mean biopsy under radiological guidance. They could be performed either on a dedicated prone table or also with a removal bed linked to your mammography device. best, there are no best techniques. These two techniques are very accurate. Best indication for stereotactic biopsy is Barrett 4 and Barrett 5 macrocalcification clusters. Also, you can perform on stereotaxy some non-calcified lesions which are not seen on ultrasound. Usually it's a little bit more challenging because due to local anesthesia after inserting into the breast, the lesions could be more, could be less visible. This is an example of a prone table. So the patient is lying prone with the breast through the table. And this is an example of a side approach with the bed linked to the mammography unit with the insertion of the needle here in the vertical approach, and also an horizontal approach is visible. Limitations of this technique, of course, is lesion not seen radiologically. So it could be the case in a very low shape calcification with amorphous calcs. For the patients with an impossibility to stay at least 15 minutes in prone or lying position. Also with very small breast, with thickness lower than 2 centimeters under compression, it could be very challenging. We could try to perform with a lateral arm. And we know that some areas are very difficult to target, especially the axilla. Also when for the very deep calcification close to pectoralis muscle, also for very superficial lesions. The side effects are extremely rare. The most common is hematoma. Also, pain is visible, such as pain after the procedure. So we have to be to aware the patients. Pneumothorax is extremely low. And also the skin defect for very lesion, very close to the skin, is still visible. So the principles of a vacuum-assisted stereotactic biopsy is the following. So we will perform a needle sampling in a circular area on 360 degrees from 12 o'clock to 10 o'clock here in this case. And we could perform one circle and two circles. Then we can remove entirely macrocalcification cluster. So that's why we have to be aware to put a titanium click in the cavity if the lesion is with very low residual calcifications or entirely removed. The accuracy of this procedure is extremely accurate and safe, and it's close to the accuracy of surgical biopsy. Here is an example of the procedure with the side approach with mammography device linked to the bed here. So the patient is located on the side. So we have to install the breast on the mammography unit and perform a compression where the calcifications could be located. Then we have to perform a central view, central acquisitions. It will define the depth. And two stereotactic views, usually plus 15, minus 15 degrees. And the combinations of these three images will give you the targets in the three axes, X, Y, Z. After local anesthesia, we can insert the needle towards the breast and perform a fire around the calcification clusters. Here's an example of the pre-fire views here with the needle and calcification clusters just in front of the needle. After fire and after the biopsy, all the calcifications were removed, and this is the image of the titanium clip inserted after the biopsy. Very important is to perform an X-ray of the samples to define if the calcifications are located through the samples for an accurate targeting as on this view. After that, you have to insert the titanium clip inside the cavity, as you can see here on this view, and perform a draft. Usually it will not bleed a lot, especially if you compress well at the end of your procedure. These are different examples of vacuum systems for biopsy, for here for a prune table. All the systems are very accurate with the same results. There are some very challenging cases, such as very deep lesions. In this case, it could be very difficult to reach these calcifications with stereotactic biopsy. If you use a prone table, it's still feasible to put the arm through the table to have a deeper approach of the pre-pectoral calcifications. And also, we recommend rather a prone table to use a side approach for very deep calcifications. In this case, you see that some very deep calcifications and irregular calcifications are located in the deep part of the breast, near in the axilla. They were very difficult to reach on a prone table. And here on this magnification view, you can see they are suspicious with irregular shape. And we decided to perform a side approach, and you can see here that these calcifications are very deep, so very challenging to biopsy. Anyway, we succeeded for the targeting with the needle here just at the limits of the window of the compression. Here after the biopsy, so we move mainly a lot of calcifications, and it was a DCIS. Some alternative techniques could be useful, such as ultrasound core vacuum biopsy for very deep calcs, especially in very thin breasts, so lower than 15 millimeters. Sometimes it will not be feasible on stereotaxy, and we could try to perform the biopsy under ultrasound. It's usually much more difficult because the calcification could be difficult to see on ultrasound. Anyway, after the biopsy, the ultrasound biopsy, we will still need a specimen X-ray to detect the calcifications in the samples. Also, an alternative technique which is interesting to know is the systems of intact biopsy, of blast biopsy, which means biopsy lesion excision system. The idea is to remove entirely a target and to combine large core biopsy and radiofrequency. It's not a treatment procedure, it's still a diagnostic procedure. How does it work? The aim is to remove the lesion in only one large specimen. It's a little bit like a small surgery. It's very interesting for the pathologist because only one specimen, and it's an easier interpretation for the pathologist. Also, it's easier and with a gain time with histological technique because we have only one specimen and not different samples for one cluster. It could be feasible on stereotaxy, on ultrasound, but not on MRI due to radiofrequency. And it could be, after discussion, of course, with multidisciplinary sessions and clinicians, an alternative technique in case the surgery will not be feasible, especially in disabled patients or with contraindication to surgery with very suspicious lesions, atypical lesions, or cancer lesions. But this, we have to be still aware that it's only normally a diagnostic technique, and if this technique could be used instead of surgery, we have to have the authorizations and to the discussion with clinicians. Here with the system, of generator of radio frequency, this is a probe, it's a 10 gauge probe. So after targeting and define the targets in stereotaxy, you will perform local anesthesia, skin incision, insert your probe through the breast and towards the lesion, then a radio frequency with act into the breast, and a small basket will circumscribe the lesion and detach the lesion from the breast, and manually we have to remove the specimen out of the breast. Here is an example of this procedure dedicated on a prone table. Here is the probe. Here is the insertion of the probe after local anesthesia. And here is the results of the procedure with a small specimen located in this small basket. So we have to cut the border of the probe to free these specimens. We can see that the size is quite big, it's 2 centimeter size. And this is the result of the radiological specimen. We removed entirely a macrocalcification cluster, and this was the result here after the pre-fire biopsy and post-fire biopsy, which is interesting, with no bleeding due to radiofrequency, no residual calcifications. So we could see the insert of titanium clip. And in this case, it was a complex benign calcification cluster with flat epithelial atypia. Here was the corresponding histological samples of this flat epithelial atypia. What could be other differential diagnosis? In this case, we have a suspicious morphologic and distribution findings of calcification clusters. It could be categorized either Barrett's 4C or Barrett's 5 due to the orientation. But the final results was not a DCIS, but was only atypical ductal hyperplasia, as you can see here in this histological results, as you can see here with proliferations of atypical cells all around. And what you see inside of the ducts here as macrocalcifications. So atypical ductal hyperplasia, it's a proliferative lesion with atypia, and usually it's associated with an increased cancer risk, higher than 4, and higher than 8 in case of familial history with breast cancer, usually around, could be detected around 50 years old. The increased risk of breast cancer confer a risk of nearly 25% at 10 years, 30% at 25 years. That's very important, that's to follow very accurately these patients for the same breast, but also for the contralateral breast, because there is an increased risk of contralateral breast cancer. So in case of atypia, usually the recommendation is to perform a surgical excision, and after that, a follow-up, a yearly follow-up during 10 years. So atypical ductal hyperplasia is nearly a low-grade DCIS. Usually they have the same morphology, and it corresponds to the proliferation of cells arising from ducts. And also the different amounts of cells in comparison with DCIS. So usually the definition is this morphology limited to 2 contiguous ducts and or size lower than 2 millimeters. With this definition, they could have good reproducibility of histological results according to pathologists. But we have to know that with stereotactic vacuum biopsy anyway, we have a risk of underestimations with percutaneous biopsy in comparison with surgery. That's why surgical excision is still recommended nowadays. And we could have about 25 to 20% of changes in DCIS or invasive cancer at surgery. Underestimation rates vary according to the size of the biopsy, and the underestimation rate is lower with bigger needle size. That's why for calcification clusters, their recommendation is to use large needle with vacuum-assisted system. Other common calcs with a differential diagnosis could be flat epithelial atypia. Definitions is columnar cell alteration with atypia. They are commonly associated with complex lesions such as low-grade DCIS, lobular carcinoma in situ, invasive ductal or lobular carcinoma. Anyway, the risk of becoming malignant is lower than atypical ductal hyperplasia, so there is a low risk of malignancy. And the underestimation rate also is lower in comparison with atypical ductal hyperplasia. This is a corresponding flat epithelial atypia with amorphous shaped calcifications clusters. Here you see the calcs within the samples and also with the proliferation cells throughout this histological sample. When you have multiple calcifications that could be difficult to detect suspicious ones with the entire breast. When you see this mammography with many, many calcifications, this is a mediolateral view, so this is a linear calcification, such as cystic calcifications, but be careful, because as you can see here, the calcifications which are deeper in the breast here are not the same shape and don't have the same orientations. As you can see here in this magnification view, these calcifications are more likely irregular in a round orientations, and they are completely different of these ones. So these ones are typically benign, they could be classified as Barrett's 2, but this one is suspicious, at least as Barrett's 4C and Barrett's 5. So the final category for this breast will not be Barrett's 2, but Barrett's 4C or Barrett's 5. And we need a biopsy for these calcifications, and these calcifications were finally a DCIS. To summarize, very important to perform an accurate analysis for macrocalcification clusters, such as in the following items. You have to analyze the morphology, density, distribution, if there are associating findings such as asymmetry, distortion, masses, and very important to know if it's evolutive or not, and to compare the mammography to previous mammography. We could define then two main categories, such as typically benign calcifications could be categorized as Barrett's 2, or suspicious calcifications which could be categorized as Barrett's 4 or Barrett's 5. Be aware of the suspicious calc which could be correspond to DCIS and atypical ductal hyperplasia. And only two entities could be categorized today at Barrett's 3. So small, round, punctated cluster of calcifications and diffuse amorphous calcifications. Finally, the diagnosis will remain on pathology, and the best technique for biopsy calcifications are vacuum stereotactic biopsy. Thank you.